Good afternoon. Trying to get a few steps in here today. Can you hear me? Let me know if you can hear me. Thumbs up if you can hear me. Hey, Pumpkin. Hey, Tracy. Hey, Rhonda. Hey, Rasha. Okay, you can hear me. Great. Hey, Alan. So, I'm inviting you to walk with me for a few minutes here. So, you know, everything that's been going on, I don't want to focus a lot on that today. I really, because it's all, right? It's all in the news. You can watch it. You know I'm posting it on my page. One of the things that I want to talk about is peace. Hey, Cynthia, I want to talk about is peace. And what I know is that, hey, Brother Allen, if I didn't say it, hey, Frank, peace is part of the reason that we're seeing what we're seeing is because people don't have peace. They don't have hope. They're frustrated. Please share. Please tag someone. They're frustrated. They're hurt. They're angry. And if we're honest, they're fearful. Fearful for their sons. Fearful for themselves. Fearful for their daughters, if they are of color. Because we do focus on our black sons and brothers and uncles and fathers. But this stuff has been coming against black women as well and young ladies. And so a lot of what you're seeing, people don't have peace. And though I know everyone, this car is so pretty, them rims are the bomb. Okay, I digress. Even though you may not serve the God that I serve, which is the great I am, hallelujah, the God of all creation, who made heaven and earth, who sits high and looks low. He knows everything that is going on. The God that I serve is a just God. He is not going to let these things go unnoticed. I know it feels like it's going unnoticed, but it's not going unnoticed. He's giving people time. He's giving police departments time. Hey, April. Hey, Renee. He's giving police departments time. He's giving the president time. He's given governors and senators and mayors and city councilmen and those in office and prosecutors, all of these people who are in positions of authority that can change the justice system and change how, hey, Candace, how people are treated, how people are handled, hey, Rod, in the system. So, and he's waiting on us. I believe that. And so he said he waits for all to come to the knowledge and the truth of him. And we know, please share, please tag. We know that everyone's not going to come to the knowledge and truth of Jesus Christ. Okay, that's cool. But he is the God of peace. The Bible says that Jesus is the Prince of Peace. So we serve the God of peace. And what we're seeing in the streets, hey, Robert, are people, Courtney, people who... Courtney, how did things go last night? I know when I was watching you, everything was very peaceful. It appears as though when you all left from downtown is when things jumped off. I was praying for you guys. What we're experiencing, not just with young people, it's not just Gen Zs and millennials. It's people my age. I don't even know what we call, right? We don't have peace about this. They arrest the primary perpetrator and he's charged with third degree murder. What is that? And then with manslaughter. But manslaughter means that there was no ill intent. But there was ill intent. Let me see. What you saying? Uh-huh. That's what I thought. Okay, babe. There was ill intent. It's just so much. And then the video comes out with the supposed EMTs that come and pick him up. And then you realize they weren't EMTs. They didn't even have on EMT uniforms. They didn't even know how to put him on the stretcher. I hate to say it, they dragged him. They didn't even know how to pick him up properly. They checked his pulse for like, what, 2 seconds? You know a real EMT, beloved, would not show up and let that police officer still have his neck on that young man's neck, on his knee on that young man's neck. You know a real EMT would not have allowed that. I don't care if he was the veteran police officer on the scene. So we see that video. We see the video of the other two officers who are holding him down behind the car. It's frustration. People become frustrated because they don't have peace. That's frustration is the absence of peace. When you don't have hope, the lack of hope or feeling hopeless, that's because you don't have peace. And there is somebody that you're not trusting. When you don't have peace and you're frustrated, it's because you don't trust somebody or you don't trust the system. Please share. Please tag. And so our young people, our adults, our mature age people, that would be me and older, amen, we're frustrated. I won't say that I don't have hope because I do have hope. I do have hope because I serve the God of hope. He is the hope of glory. So I serve the God of hope. However, fear. Now, they seem fearless, right? Because they going out there turning stuff over, marching, no justice, no peace, F-12. If y'all don't know what that means, Google it. You know, they saying all of that. So there is a fearlessness, but that doesn't mean that they don't fear. They don't fear that it could be their brother. It could be their sister. It could be their uncle. It could be their cousin. That doesn't mean that. And people should not have to live in a country and be fearful. People should not live in a country where injustice is so blatantly obvious. So I know many of you got the video that I did of the white young man in his, I think it was a Jeep. And there's a policeman who has gotten in his car and he's trying to push him out the car. And then there's a policeman at his door, driver's side door, trying to pull him out of the car. And he's fighting him. And he's doing this and he's hitting him. And they eventually start hitting him. But they don't pull him out and slam him on the ground, right? They don't even tase him. And they definitely didn't shoot him. It's the inequalities that you see with your own eyes. Ain't nobody walking around eyes wide shut. Our eyes are very wide open and we know what's going on and we see what's going on. And that's the anger that it keeps happening. So one of my concerns or one of the purposes of this video today, as you walk with me, and I thank you for walking with me on this beautiful day, tag, share with someone, invite someone. I can't read your comments, but I will when I get stationary. We know that at these protests, there are many people of other communities. There are white people, Asians, Latinos. There's everybody, right? And that's beautiful. But these organizers have been saying for years that when things jump off and go left, it's not the protesters. It's not the organizers, right? And I put out a post saying, I apologize for thinking that it was young people in their own communities burning down things. But then I kept thinking, how could they be over here and a fire is burning, but then there's a fire burning over there? How is that possible? Well, now we know. There are agitators and extremists and white supremacists who come, and people who are actually hired to come and take a protest to riot, right? Now, let me say this, like I have to say all the time, these disclaimers, so we know all white people ain't supremacists, white supremacists, we know that everybody that supports Trump is not a white supremacist. They would even tell you that they're not a racist, right? They'll defend that he's not a racist. I don't quite know how they can do that about him, but they certainly can say that about themselves, right? We give them the freedom of speech and the right to say that, and the presumption of their innocence, of being not being racist. Just like every black person isn't ignorant, every black woman isn't angry, every black man isn't lazy and doesn't take care of his kids. So we don't generalize anybody, okay? Let's get back to these people who are paid and or people who just show up to bring negativity into the environment, okay? Amen. So they're now recognizing this at a national level. Matter of fact, the attorney general that works for Trump, he just came out and gave a statement. Unfortunately, he kind of went left on us when he said a couple of things. But and just before that, the POTUS had done an interview before he got on his plane, and he said something about it. And then he said, MAGA loves the blacks. That's what he said. He said, MAGA loves the blacks. Lord have mercy. That's what he said. Jesus. So, Lord have mercy. But I don't even want to get into why would black people vote for him. I don't even understand that. With all of the history of his racism, I don't understand that. Jesus. That's like you drinking spoiled milk. You know it's spoiled. You can smell that it's spoiled, but you still gonna drink it. And it is not sour cream. Hello. It's not that. Right? It's not cottage cheese that you put with your pineapples. No, it's spoiled milk. It's not sour cream. It's not sour milk that you make with certain cakes and stuff. So, no, that's not what it is. But we're not going to get in that. So here we go. So, this lack of peace. And my prayer this morning, early this morning, was, Lord, just give people peace. Give people peace. Give Brother Joy Floyd's family peace. And I don't think peace is going to come until all of those officers have been arrested. It's not going to come. I don't believe. It's not. And they're charged at the right degree according to what they did. Now, some would say, well, they can't charge him for first degree murder because it wasn't premeditated. Okay. All right. But he should get second. He should get second. And let's also be mindful that the FBI is still investigating. And there's still a possibility that the state's attorney general, Mr. Ellison, Attorney Ellison, could still take over the case. So let's be prayerful about those things, that the right level of punishment and justice is given for Brother George's life and for his family and for that community and for the world. And what people don't understand is that the first cities that broke out and started protesting, except maybe Indianapolis, was cities that had outstanding cases where policemen have not been charged or arrested, right? Or there was such an injustice in their city of a murder, like Kentucky, like Georgia, Texas. We can just keep going, right? So that's a part of what was going on. Now, what I did not realize about Minneapolis or Minnesota was that they have had like 5 cases in the last 5-10 years or so that are still where police officers just got off. But the one time a police officer did not get off was I'm not sure if he was African or was his religion just Muslim. I can't remember. But he accidentally shot a white woman. Hey, Amp. Hey, Sharon. Accidentally shot a white woman, and he was immediately arrested. He was charged. He was kept in jail. And he was sentenced to 12 years. So And it sounds like he was charged with manslaughter or third degree, which is what they're trying to charge this dude with. And his wasn't no accident. His wasn't an accident. So let's be prayerful for the peace of his family, the peace of people, because that's what the protesters want. That's what the organizers want. They want peaceful protest. But it's hard to have peaceful protest when you're angry, when you're frustrated, when there's a anxiousness, a worry, a fear. I saw Niecy Nash on CNN. I think it was CNN. And she was telling the story about how her son, just a few days ago, maybe a week ago, went out and was pulled over by the police because he made a rolling stop at a stop sign. And when he did that, hey, Pastor Brian, hey, Carla, hey, Sharon, that when he made this rolling stop, he was stopped. Okay. He said, of course, everything was in order, gave him his registration, gave him his license. The policeman said to him, it was two cars that pulled him over. The policeman said, it's your lucky day. What kind of mess is that? It's my lucky day. It's my lucky day. And so the other thing they said was, how you get a car like this? I don't know what he's driving. Niecy didn't tell us what he was driving, but that's what they asked. So it made me think about when I was pulled over. I used to drive sports cars. That's all I drove. And unfortunately, I used to have a lead foot in my 20s, early 30s. And interestingly, when I was doing the wrong thing, I would never get pulled over, right? So it's kind of like what my dad used to say. This whooping is for all the whoopings you didn't get that I didn't know what you had done. So I was pulled over a couple of times. Pulled over. And I used to get really smart with the police. Like, what? Why are you pulling me over? I mean, I used to be like defiant steak, you know? Now, mind you, this was 30 years ago, 20 years ago. I wouldn't do that today. Maturity, you know, whatever. Just wouldn't do that today. Not even out of fear. I just wouldn't. That's not my personality anymore. But, you know, you're in your 20s. You're a little bit rebellious and all that, right? So, but I also remembered in 2012, I was pulled over. I just got my convertible. And I don't even think it was down that day. It was probably a day like this. I don't think it was down. So I make this left turn. And I hear the room and the lights. And I'm like, why are they pulling me over? And so when he comes, I let the window down and I lean like this to look up at him. And he had his little hand on his waist. I ain't gonna say it was on his gun. And I was like, yes. I guess I was still a little bit perturbed. And I said, yes. And he said, you made a left turn with no signal. I said, huh? What do you mean I made a left turn? I said, the light hadn't turned green? And he said, no, you didn't turn on your signal light. I said, but I was in the left turning lane, so you knew I was turning left. And he was like, well, you still have to use your signal. I said, okay. I don't think I ever called him officer, but anyway, this is my story. Hey, Brother Cornell. One of them. So he said, and may I ask you something? That's what he said. He said, I want to ask you something. That's how he said it. I said, I'm still leaning, looking up at him, because I'm memorizing his badge number. And I said, okay. He said, I said, what? Which, now, he wasn't being stank. Let me be clear. He wasn't being stank. He wasn't being rude. So I said, let me lighten my spirit. So I said to him, what you want to ask me something? I said, what you going to ask me out for a date or something? And he was like, no. I said, okay. And he said, what does your license plate mean? I said, excuse, I'm still leaning like, what? He never asked me for my driver's license. He didn't ask me for my registration. I said, what does my, hey, Stephanie, hey, Alicia, what does my license plate mean? So my license plate said, he's able. So it was an H, a backwards 3, and able. I said, what are you? He said, what is your, and it was another officer, like back the behind and the rear of my car. And I could look in my rearview mirror and see him. in my side mirror, I could see him. I said, my license plate says he's able. The 3 is turned backwards because the 3 represents the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God is able. So I must have said it loud enough for the other officer to hear me. And I heard him go, oh, and then he kind of shook his head at him. And he was like, okay. I was like, okay. I said, can I say something? And he said, yeah. I said, you don't know me and I don't know you. And I'm, you know, my saying, I'm dust going back to dust, meaning we ain't nobody no way compared to God. I said, but let's just say someone drove by and saw me, this car, he's able, they know it's my plate, they know it's my car, they whip out their camera, and there I go on all the social media because you pulled me over to ask me what my plate means. He was like, oh, you could explain it. I'm like, I said, what if I had the type of job that didn't allow for this type of interaction with a police officer? Please tag, please share. And he was like, this is what he said. He said, there are jobs like that. I said, okay. I said, all right, is that it? He said, yeah. I said, okay. I think I wished him a nice day. He was like, okay, have a nice day. He said, be sure to use your turn signal when you're turning left. I said, okay. So he said, nice day. I said, nice day. So that was it. So this is unfortunately what we have to deal with and contend with in this world. And that's nothing compared to what Brother George had to deal with. And I said in one of my posts, we need our white brothers and sisters and comrades to join us in this. And it's great that we saw, again, as I said earlier, all of those nationalities and communities, right? And cultures and races out there. That was great. That was great. It was great. I saw one video where the whole front line posted up against the police were Caucasian young men locked in arms. I said, okay, you know, that's great. We know that there are many of them who stand with us and cry with us and are offended. There was a post I put on my page of a young lady, a woman who was in her car driving, and she was talking about the outrage that she had and how, you know, white people need to, you know, speak up. And that's great. That's great. What I would ask, please share, please tag, share with your Caucasian brothers and sisters. What I would ask is that it not just be for Brother George Floyd, even though that's our focus right now, and it needs to be our focus so that he and his family and that community can get justice, but it needs to be for all the Georges. You know, Brother Steele, who was from Minnesota, you know, all of these young people, the young lady in Kentucky, the one in Dallas, where she was in her house with her nephew and the police came in her backyard and shot it up. All of these instances where, and the young lady in Kentucky, her boyfriend was arrested immediately for defending his home. Immediately. But it take y'all days, if never, to arrest these officers when it's blatant. It's blatant. It's blatant. Thank you, Mary, for sharing. And so I don't want our, it's great that you stand with us and you do videos and you get 10 million views. That's great. That's great. However, and I posted her video to my page and I inboxed her to be in dialogue with her because I want to hear her heart. But what's important is that it not be about this one incident, that your injustice rises to the tens and twenties and hundreds of black men who have been mistreated in our black community, period. Now, I go to her page and because I'm moved like everybody. That's why she got 10,000 views, 10 million views, because you're moved, right? So I go to her page. She ain't never said nothing about racism. She's never said any, at least that I see. And I know when you're not friends with someone, you don't see everything. But She ain't never said there was no other post about injustice, none of the other things that have been happening across the country, all the things I just listed and the ones I haven't listed, none of those here. And I scrolled and I scrolled and I scrolled. I ain't seen none of that. And I see who she supports. I see who she speaks against. But like I said earlier, everybody that supports Trump is not a racist. Everybody that supports Trump is not a white supremacist. Everybody that supports Trump, they have hearts. They're concerned about humanity. They have a platform that he's moving for them, which is abortion, conservative judges, if you got money, tax breaks, and what's the third thing, Holy Spirit? What's the fourth thing? So they have a platform for about four things. And that's what they get behind, particularly if they're quote unquote Christian conservatives. I think one thing as Christians, we have to stop making or letting the world think that the only Christians are Republicans. They are Democrat Christians. And we've let the world think this mother teaching her sons how to mow the lawn. I love it. Republicans are not the only Christians, okay? So as Democrats, we have to start communicating our values as Christians. They may not agree with yours. You may be a Democrat that's a Christian that believes that a woman has a right to choose. That doesn't mean that you support abortion. What you support is a woman's right to choose. And how she chooses is between her and God. You may feel, as a Democrat, that you don't have the right to try to legislate a woman's uterus. That doesn't mean you're not a Christian and you don't love God. So we have to learn how to communicate our message, because I just believe there are a lot of Republicans who think like us, who think like that, but they don't have enough Democrats saying it. And so they can't get behind you. So start speaking it. So what I want for my Caucasian brothers and sisters who are going to stand with us is to stand in the totality of the injustice that has been done against African American people. That you really do believe that Black lives matter, and you're not going to throw in All Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter. You're going to be like, no, we're talking about Black lives right now. Because when was the last time your son left the house and was pulled over and was told, it's your lucky day? When was the last time your son left the house and was asked, how you get this car? What you doing? When was the last time your son left the house and was pulled over and was slammed to the ground and you weren't resisting arrest, but he ended up dead? He didn't make it home. And you have that fear that you have to tell your white son or daughter or nephew or brother or husband. Now, when the police comes, this is what you do. If you're ever pulled over, this is what you do. And understand, you could be doing nothing and end up in handcuffs. You could be nothing. You could be doing nothing and find yourself dead. That does not happen to your sons. So we need you. Thank you for the video that drew 10 million views. Thank you for all of those videos. You know, God has laid on my heart, and he had done it months ago, and now I know why, about bringing together my Caucasian sisters, as I say, the sisters from another mother, but the same father, meaning God, our father, Jesus, our brother, to have this open dialogue. And I believe that coming together as women who love Jesus, we can move anything. Oh my God, yes, I believe it. So that's an old African proverb saying. I messed it up, but y'all get the point. So this is my prayer for us as a community. In the end, it cannot just be about George while you're outraged, Brother George Floyd. You should be outraged. We're all outraged. We should be so outraged that we demand for his charges to be increased. Hey, Renita. That his charges be increased to second degree murder. Maximum for that is 40 years. Maximum for third degree is only 25, and he could be out in 15, 16, 17 years for killing a man. Oh my God. 9 minutes. 8 minutes and 46 seconds. Yeah, let's be clear. 8 minutes and 46 seconds, he had his knee on that brother's neck with him crying out, "I can't breathe." Oh, Jesus, calling out to his mother. That I haven't watched the video in its totality. I've seen parts and pieces just because they might show it on the news or, but I've never, and I'm not going to, because I'm not going to receive all of that into my spirit. I haven't sat down and watched the whole video, and I'm not going to. But almost 9 minutes, and almost 3 minutes of that, 2 minutes and 53 seconds, his knee was on him after he was unconscious. And the truth is, they believe he was dead by then. Now, why is the issue with the autopsy of the medical examiner? Because he said there was no evidence of asphyxiation. How is that possible? When your knee was on my neck and I'm telling you I can't breathe. Well, I heard Van Jones say that back in the 90s, there had been a policy. Was Rodney King in the 90s? It must have been, because I think that's what he said. There became this policy that it was called death by circumstance or something like that. And it, according to the medical examiner's report, it would give police an out. So he said how they worded it can be a problem. So his family is asking for an independent medical examination, and they should. And they should. And so these are the things that I encourage us to pray about. I encourage us to pray about and be standing with his family, that the other three are arrested this week and charged. This weekend would be great, because I got a feeling these young people across the country gonna keep going until all three are arrested. Now, the dude who did it all, he has bonded out. He's bonded out. He bonded out, and his wife and filed for divorce. Because you know he wasn't kind to her. That kind of evil. Did y'all put the pictures of him that day with Brother George and his arrest picture? Did y'all put them together? The evil that was in his eyes. The evil when he had on that mega hat. That level of evil. Call it a spirit, call it what you want, but he was evil. That wasn't nothing but the devil. So you know if he would do that, he probably was mistreating her at home. What you think? And she said, her sister said, her mama said, her kids said, you need to leave. Because if he would do that to them, and look how he's been treating you, he will probably end up doing that to you. If he hasn't already done something to her. So she filed for divorce. I don't blame her. Because y'all ain't gonna be messing with me. Because I'm with him. And she about know he crazy. So let me get on up out of here. So, good for her. Good for her. So, we thank God for the truth being revealed. And it's coming out, unfortunately. It's trickling. But remember, it was trickling water that created the Grand Canyon. Amen. A consistent trickling of water created the Grand Canyon. Yeah, that's it. Thank you, honey. Yeah, Rodney King, 1991. Yep, that's what he said. So, I want us to, again, just pray for the peace of our land, of our country, of our cities, of our young people, of all people. Pray their hope. Pray that all the truth comes out. And the canyon that's being built, all of the guilty parties will fall into it. See, y'all don't pray like me. Y'all scared. I don't care. I told y'all the other day, I pray like David. Let them fall into the pit they dug for me. Break their jaw. Cause them to get entangled in the net that they wanted me to be entangled in. That's how you got to pray. Y'all can't be these little penny ante. Lord Jesus, that's good. That's good. But when you in a war, you better pray the war prayers, honey. Good God Almighty. So let's pray and let's agree that, yeah, come on, cousin. Yeah, anybody got time to be praying? No, you know, patty cake prayers. That's cute. But this is about life and death. And God said, put me in remembrance of his word. Jesus was outraged when he came in the temple and they were selling stuff. You need to be outraged that black people's souls are being, their souls, S-O-U-L, their lives are being sold to evil. Yeah, now I heard somebody say, they were talking about how these young people were looting, but we've already dealt with, yeah, some of the black kids and all them, they were looting. But we know that the windows getting broken out and a lot of that, and the fires were being set by paid agitators. And they talked about, you know, they said, look, this nation was founded on looting. Boston Tea Party, they looted the Indians. I mean, come on. They all, you know, this country has stolen all of our stuff. Black culture pimped it. We let them do it. Jesus. And now, you know, I am not justifying what they did, what was going on. The ones who started it and the ones who participated when the wind of opportunity blew their way to go in the Target and the liquor store and all of these places to steal stuff. I'm not justifying that at all. But I've been saying this for weeks, months. The spirit of lawlessness has entered this country. Lawlessness, no regard for the law, no respect for the law. And it started at the head. It is a spirit of lawlessness. He has broken every law, marital law, financial laws, business laws. He's broken every law, relationship laws. He's broken every law, governmental laws, justice laws. He's broken every law. Lawlessness has entered the land. Every president releases a spirit in this country. Oh, get with it. Go do your study. Just think about it. Just think about who released sexual immorality. Not just immorality, because there's somebody else who released, and I ain't gonna go through them. Sexual immorality. Who released the spirit of poverty when they started taking everything from specifically poor people? When they start rolling back programs, those are spirits that were released. Sexual immorality was released. And then there was immorality of all kinds released. So he's released lawlessness. So we have to pray concerning those things. Okay, beloved? I love you with the love of the Lord, and I thank you for walking with me. Share this with someone. Tag someone. I want to pray over you as I walk and close this out. I want to pray over your peace and the protection of you and your family and your children. Amen. So, Father God, we just thank you for who you are, and I thank you for those who have walked with me this afternoon, and I pray the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, that it'll guard their heart and their mind in you. Lord, I know some people under the sound of my voice don't even believe in you. They don't believe in your son. They may believe in you, but they don't believe in Jesus. But you're such a loving God. You set the rains on the just and the unjust, and the sun shines on the just and the unjust. And all that means is that we are justified by our faith because we have called on the name of Jesus. And so we are the just, and the just shall live by faith. So God, according to that faith, I pray over this country. Lord Jesus, I pray, God, for the president of the United States. Lord God, Donald Trump, Lord, he holds the position, but there's so much about what he does that is not presidential, that is not representative of the character of a president, of the actions of a president that cares for all people, the things he says, the things he does. So God, I ask that you touch his heart, that you change his heart. God, give him a Damascus Road experience. Knock him off his high horse, Lord. Do whatever needs to be done, God, to bring him into you. I know, Lord, that they're saying he's a Christian, but he said with his own mouth, he's never asked for forgiveness. So it's impossible to be a believer if you've never confessed Jesus Christ and asked him for forgiveness for the pardon of your sins. So God, I pray. I pray for our brown sons and our black sons and our caramel vanilla sons, God. I pray for those born into the lineage of African and they live here in America. So God, I pray for them. I pray your protection, God. I pray your blood, the blood of Jesus over them, God, in the name of Jesus. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for who you are. I pray, God, for those who are protesting today, that it be peaceful. I pray somebody's joining me in this prayer right now. All of those under the sound of my voice, 40-something people, keep it going, keep it going. Share, tag, invite somebody. Let's pray together as we walk. God, we thank you. We ask for your protection. We ask for your peace. We ask for order in the name of Jesus, God, to bring it out. Hallelujah. The National Guard, Lord have mercy, in Minneapolis. And who knows what's going on in other cities. The totality of it, the little bit, Lord God, that we see on Facebook, God, and on the news, Lord. But I ask you, God, to cover those, God, who are trying to protest right and bring conviction to those who are doing the wrong thing, God. Like when that man stole my car and, Lord have mercy, you made him fall asleep in the car and you sent me exactly to where the car was and he was sleeping. Hallelujah. And I retrieved my car and good God Almighty, Lord God, I just thank you. I thank you what you're able to do. I thank you for what you're able to do. And I ask you, Lord, to keep your people, to keep the mothers and the mothers who are worried, the mothers who are scared, the mothers who are concerned, the mothers and fathers who are talking to their sons before they leave the house, who wants them back in before dark and they're 21 because they're concerned. For those who are going to the protests right now and they're going hoping that they can get the ear of somebody who's trying to do something wrong and get them to change their mind. So God, we pray. We pray for favor. I pray the blessings of the Lord over your children, over those who have called upon your name. They are blessed going in and blessed going out. They bless when they lay down. They bless when they rise. Hallelujah. Their storehouses, which will be your bank accounts, are blessed. Hallelujah. Their threshing floors are blessed. That would be your investments. So God, I thank you. I thank you for more than enough that you're pouring out on us. Give us clean hands, God, and a pure heart. Let our hearts be satisfied with you and at peace with you. In the name of Jesus, you said, if our heart does not condemn us, we can ask for anything. So God, we ask for forgiveness for anything we've said or done that was against you, that was not like you. And Lord, I should have said that prayer before I started praying, but I thank you, you receive it now. So Lord, bless your people. Bless your people. Keep them safe. Keep them healthy. Hallelujah. In this COVID season. And so, Daddy, I love you. I love you, God. Man, I love you. You are an amazing Daddy God. I love you. Bless their marriages and their family and their children and their finances and their jobs and their ministry and their businesses. Their health. Bless their parents. Hallelujah, Jesus. Keep them. Keep them. Cover us. Send our ministering angels before us, and we know that goodness and mercy will follow us, God. So we thank you today. And we love you, Daddy. In Jesus' awesome, precious, the strong name of Jesus. We say amen. I love you with the love of the Lord. Please share this with someone. Tag someone. Hey, Mary. Hey, Sister Ann. Hey, Sister Lynn. Hey, Valerie. Hey, Pastor Ken. All right, guys, I have finished my walk. I don't know how long I talked to you guys, but amen. I'm almost at the crib. Enjoy your day. God bless. Go back, replay. This prayer is for you who replay as well. I pray that you hear something in the replay that blesses you, and gives you understanding. Please share with our Caucasian brothers and sisters, because there's a word in here for them. Amen. And so we thank you and we love you. Hallelujah. Amen.